Hi, I'm Dustin Mason at Performance Lexus in St. Catharines. And before we get this video started, make sure you hit subscribe so you can see all of our future content coming down the pipeline. Today, we are comparing a 2022 LC500 with this 2016 Jaguar F-Type R. Now, first, you might ask yourself why, because those cars seem very different. Two reasons. One is when this Jaguar got traded in, I was impressed with how many similarities this had with our LC. And the second reason is for a used car buyer, if you're looking at a pre-owned Jaguar, you might be considering a pre-owned LC. And there definitely are some strengths and weaknesses beside them, and it's up for you to decide which one you like. So after you watch the video, make sure you put in the comments which one you choose between the two. So the first thing to talk about is the powertrain. Although similar, they are very different. The Jaguar features a supercharged V8, around 550 horsepower, and is an all-wheel drive. On this particular one, is all-wheel drive with an 8-speed automatic transmission. The LC, on the other hand, is also a V8, but with a 10-speed automatic transmission and is on a rear-wheel drive platform. Now, the first similarity to point out is both of these cars are the best sounding V8s I've ever heard in my entire life. Now, I know from my history with Lexus that the exhaust note of the LC500 did take up to 5 years to perfect and is in harmony with perfect octaves. I'm not a musician, but the result of that is absolutely amazing to the ear. As you're accelerating, the tones just sound like they're meant to be to each other. And the Jaguar is exactly the same in my opinion. So, right now, I'm gonna play the exhaust note from the LC. And now the Jaguar. You can tell they both have that similar flat plane crank engine noise with some crackles, some pops. The Jaguar has kind of that roar when started up, but both sound absolutely amazing. You could not go wrong with either one. Now, looking at the front fascia of both of them, we do see some differences here. The Jaguar kind of goes to more of a point with that smaller grille and kind of narrows down. And the headlights kind of follow suit, very rounded with a little bit of, you know, slits here and there for intake, etc. And then that car really does widen out. Super long, you know, body lines that, you know, create a very wide but short vehicle with a really low roofline. And the LC is a little bit different in this sense. The LC still kind of looks like a concept car, which I love about it. So when you're looking at the front of the LC, we still have, you know, a wedge shape kind of, you know, narrowing down on the top, but still keeping that grille nice and open. It's that, you know, F-Sport style grille. And the headlights, the daytime running lights still wrap into the headlight housing. And that's what kind of makes it seem like a concept still. Now, triple beam LED headlights, and when you look up closely to it, you see things written on it like Lexus, and you see a little bit of artwork on the headlight lens. Jaguar does their own version of that. Okay, so an important thing when looking at cars that people always forget to do is check out the headlights and signal lights, because that's a big part of the car that, you know, people are gonna see you on the road, and sometimes you won't even know what the signals look like. So on the Jaguar, we have everything kind of close together. We have our daytime running light that wraps around the bottom, and then underneath that is where the signal is. It does surprisingly look more modern than you would think with it off. And I think that creates a little bit of a timeless look to it. It's not gonna look super outdated, but the LC on the other end has a lot more going on. So we have way more spread out here. We have the daytime running light that wraps into that housing, a triple beam LED headlight, and then a signal that's kind of separate and down the side there. I think it's all about preference. The LC perhaps looks a little more modern. That car came out, you know, closer to 2018, where this one is in 2016, kind of more at the end of its run. So it makes sense that there'd be some differences there. You know, one a little more timeless, one a little more modern. I think it's all about preference. You know, I don't know if I would ever buy or not buy a car because of how the headlights look, but it always is good to check out. A big similarity between the two cars is the door handles. At first glance, it almost seems identical. So we'll look at the Jaguar first. On the Jaguar, we have these door handles that sort of fold in and fold out. It says Jaguar on the top. There is a little bit of aluminum there, which is nice. It does seem super high end. Now I noticed when the vehicle's sitting, the Jaguar handle does stay out. And that's a little bit different on the LC. You can press that and it'll honk twice at you. And it is a different honk than the actual horn on the car, which is interesting. So I think that's because the key's in there right now. But on the LC, so when the car sits for X amount of seconds, it does go back flush. And when you hit unlock, it pops back out like the Jaguar. But if not, you can just override it. Press, you know, it on a little bit on the edge there, and we still see a little bit of a Lexus emblem there. And you can just pull it open, and very similar on the two cars. Both have really solid doors too. The LC seems a little heavier to open and close, but both of them, you know, really good thud, and they don't feel cheap at all, that's for sure. At the back of the F-Type, the first thing you're gonna notice is the taillights. I wanna call it a tail line, because all it is just a single line that kind of wraps around and goes to that side, and makes you realize how big this rear quarter panel is. Not only does the bumper wrap around, but this quarter panel wraps around the top of the back of the car and makes it so that the opening of the hatch is actually quite narrow. It's very centered instead of being like the whole back of the car, which opens. I really like that. It gives it a really sleek look at the back. It really makes it look like a fastback. And I just think, it's really cool. And then it kind of just, you know, stops, and then we have a quad exhaust setup with a nice lip at the bottom. And this is an active spoiler. This actually does open up, which is kind of cool, and the Jaguar logo there. Now, for the hatch, it is power. It's supposed to be power. It didn't work that time. Probably something I did wrong. The size isn't super big. I read online that you could fit two golf bags. I don't know if that's true. Definitely one golf bag because it is long. And there is no rear seat, so there's a little bit of space there. And has this little tonneau cover. There is a little bit of storage underneath the fake floor. And mostly that's just where the tire repair kit is because it is run flats. But overall, I really like the design of the back of the F-Type. I think that's one of the strengths of the car. I probably prefer the rear of this car over the front, actually, personally. But overall, looks great. So at the back of the LC, if you haven't noticed yet, this one is a convertible that we're reviewing today. So because it's a convertible, it does make it seem quite elongated back here because of that soft top versus the Jaguar, which is a little more stubby, a little more cut off. So all about preference there. But the taillights are absolutely gorgeous. So we have that kind of hologram look for the taillights. It kind of looks like there's an infinite amount of taillights because of some mirror and some trickery in there. At first I thought it was just, you know, supposed to be like a hologram or something like that from Lexus, but I heard it's supposed to represent kind of an afterburner effect from like a jet engine, like a fighter jet, something like that. And the signals are this long piece here, which is pretty cool. We don't have quad exhausts on this one. It is more of a flush tailpiece at the bottom there. Now, interesting enough, I heard about this recently where as we kind of see what happens in the future in the car industry, there are gonna be more hybrids, more electric cars. And what we're noticing is with these hybrids and obviously electric cars, but hybrids in particular, there is no exhaust really. They're kind of tucking that exhaust underneath. So if we fast forward 10, 15 years from now, if most of the cars driving around are going to be EVs or hybrids without exhaust pipes, I think a buyer, as yourself perhaps, might want to think about, you know, do they want their car to stick out and have, you know, look like it's ancient or kind of fit in with everything. I personally like to be different, so I would want to stick out, but not everybody's like me, I guess. So that's what Lexus has at the bottom there. I have customized one of these LCs to have quad exhaust and it did look great. But you know, at least that's something you can change if you wanted. Now for the trunk, the button for the trunk is hidden on this little tail light right here. And when you pop it, since this is the convertible, there's not a whole lot of room in here. I don't have a golf bag on me right now, but I don't think many golf clubs would fit in here. But There is enough storage for the little wind guard that you can install over the rear seats. You know, a couple little knickknacks here and there, maybe some cleaning products, and that's pretty much all you're gonna get back there. But on the LC, you do have a little bit of a back seat, so you could put a backpack, you could put some groceries, you could put your golf clubs back there if you needed to. Okay, so inside, there is a lot to unpack. But first, we are in Canada, so we need to see, does it fit a Tim Hortons coffee cup? So we're just gonna open up the cup holders and see, and it does. So I passed that test, passed the Canadian test. Okay, everything else. So the first thing you notice when you get in is the shape of the steering wheel. It kind of has that flat bottom, which is really nice. Picture of a Jaguar, and the horn doesn't sound too pipsqueaky. So that's actually a good thing, I guess. We do have some steering wheel controls on here, cruise controls, heated steering wheel button is actually on the steering wheel. The paddle shifters feel to be metal, and they are a little smaller, but they're positioned well. There is that spot on the steering wheel to be able to like wrap your thumbs around, which I really like. The thing about European cars is I never know where to look for the push button. This one is right here, kind of in the center. So we're just gonna press that a few times, and that is going to wake up all of the buttons and switches that we have, because there are a lot of them. So right beside the shift knob, we have the different drive modes. And it's interesting because sort of the way that the switch works is the platform around the switch actually stays stationary, and then the switch part itself slides on that platform, which is, you know, something maybe you would miss if not paying attention, but I noticed it right away. And that changes it from, you know, dynamic mode to regular mode to a snow and rain mode, which is all pretty self-explanatory. That dynamic mode also turns on the valves in the exhaust to make the engine more, or the exhaust notes more loud. And there is a button for that standalone as well. So you can do that, from what I can tell, in every mode. And that's just right here, kind of just below the shifter. To the left of that, we can turn the traction control off. With the car started, of course. And then we also have the auto start-stop feature that you can override from here as well. And to the right of that, we have an active wing that we can turn on and up, and that lifts up from the back. If someone didn't show you that, you wouldn't even know that there was an active wing there. So that's really cool. The volume knob is right in the center, so you don't have to like reach up to do that. You can kind of just be focused on the road, one hand on the wheel, and where your arm feels very natural, that's where the volume knob is. I always like when cars have that, and I do like when they also have a knob. To the right of that is this handle here. So I like seeing this in cars because usually it's cars that are meant to be, you know, driven spiritedly. And that's for the passenger to be able to hold on, or the driver, but the driver should have both of their hands on the wheels. The Lexus LC has this as well, and I've always thought it was well placed and well used sometimes, depending on who you're driving with. To the left of that and above the volume knob, there is a cover for a cigarette outlet or 12-volt outlet. So this car was a 2016, so it still had outlets everywhere instead of things like USB-Cs and stuff, which is fine. And then we have some switches up here for the climate control. Now, a very fun thing about the climate control that I discovered is when you press and turn on the center vents, magic happens, and the dashboard opens up to reveal two new vents that weren't there a second ago, which is really cool. And again, when you shut that off, or when you turn off the climate control, those will go back into the dashboard. The thing I love about automotive the most is things like that, where is it super useful to hide those vents? No, but it's cool, and it's cool to show your friends. It's like a party trick. And I just love unnecessary things in cars. I think that's what separates special cars from the overly produced boring cars. Not that I find a ton of cars boring, but that's really cool. And I love it, and I wish more cars had it. The screen, it's a 2016, so nothing super exciting here in terms of resolution, but it does have backup camera. It does have a way to pair your phone. However, it's from the center here, and I think it's a special Jaguar cable. So that is what it is. I'm not super surprised because of that, but you can access the backup camera even, you know, when parked. And there is like things like parking sensors, obviously Bluetooth, and all those things. Another cool detail that you find in high-end cars is something like how to open the glove box, for instance. And the reason I point that out is because if, think about it, you only go in your glove box, I don't know, is it once a month or less than that? Maybe a couple times a year. But to open the glove box on this Jaguar is this little button here. And there's something about that that I find cool. It would have been so much easier for them just to use a little handle under here that, you know, was maybe mass produced for Land Rover or Ford or something like that. But instead, they have this little button. And it's just a more elegant way of opening that glove box, which we all know is only gonna be used once in a while. Up on the main dashboard here. So as I mentioned, it is a small car inside, which it's supposed to be. It is a true two-seater. It is a true sports car, supercar, whatever you wanna call it. Now, what I did notice is when I have the seat all the way back, for me, I'm comfortable for sure, but the seat rubs a little bit. And I don't know if it's because this one's a little bit pre-owned, but to my left here, it is rubbing on the door panel just a little bit. So I would probably just adjust it up just a tad so I don't hear that rubbing as I'm driving. The seats overall, super comfortable. They are a little bit stiff. I think they're Recaro's, but I don't see a brand yelling at me anywhere. A little bit stiff, but super comfortable, even though it's a pre-owned, you know, that seat material still held up really nicely. And I do feel very well in place. On the gauge, we don't have, you know, too much going on here, just a simple TFT display in the middle. And I think you can just control it kind of through the steering wheel here. Nothing really to write home about, just your normal stuff. Pretty simple and straightforward. And to the left of the steering wheel, we just have things like, you know, a pop for the trunk, some dimmer switches, things like that. Actually, a really cool thing about the dimmer switch is you can kind of push it back into the dash or press it again and it comes out. So that's a little detail. The seat controls are all on the door and there actually is a decent amount. There we have lots of lumbar. We even have side bolsters, which is an important feature in a car like this because you can decide how much you want that seat to hug you. I'm super skinny, so I really like it to hug me. That way I'm not sliding around in the seat a whole lot. And I like that you can program that and also have you know, the memory setting for that as well. The sound system in here is Meridian Surround. There are a few variations of this. This one I think is the higher one. There is just a Meridian one as well. If I'm wrong, let me know in the comments. Again, I don't know a ton about Jaguars, just my brief little research that I've done on this one. Center mirror is pretty small and I like it, but the thing I like most actually is the visors that come down are the smallest sun visors I've ever seen in my entire life. And I mean that. They're very skinny. They are made of like an Alcantara, very nice material. And the mirror itself is this little itty bitty. I can kind of look at my eyes if I want, or I can look at my lips, but not either one of them together. And again, I don't think it's a bad thing. I just think it's kind of cute and cool. It is a very small thing inside here. So whatever makes it different, in my opinion, I like. We also have a little bit of, it's kind of like a carbon fiber vinyl applied to a lot of these interior pieces. It definitely doesn't feel like real carbon fiber. In fact, it's definitely not. It is like an exposed kind of wrap that they have on there. But overall, the interior is not too bad for what the car is. It's a driver car, so, you know, I don't see too many shortcuts in here. Everything seems to be sort of soft touch. And yeah, overall pretty good inside. So as long as you don't need a big interior in your sports car or supercar, this one is, it definitely does the trick. Even for me, I'm 6'1", I still have lots of headroom. I'm not too sure about the glass roof, but I did just notice even the material of the roof is quite nice. It's like a leather vinyl or something like that. So that'll probably hold up well over time. Okay, so in the interior of the LC, it does feel a lot more spacious than the Jaguar. Now again, it's all about preference. The Jaguar to me feels like that supercar track car. I should put on a helmet and race it on the track. This feels more like I could drive it to work every day. And it's almost like they took the front of a luxury sedan and placed it on two doors. So a little bit different vibe there. The steering wheel on the LC is rounded without a flat bottom, and you'll remember the Jaguar has a flat bottom, and it does seem a little bit smaller than the Jaguar as well. So that's interesting. Something they share in common is the handle kind of right here for the passenger or the driver, whoever's gonna hold on to that, which I love on fast cars because it gives you something to hold on to or someone for the passenger to hang on to. So that's there as well. We do have two cup holders on the LC, but they are spaced out a little bit. We have one up here and then one kind of right here a little bit, which is kind of funny. So yeah, it's kind of hidden there. But when you close this, you'll notice it slows down towards the end there. So it goes normal speed and then slows right down. That is supposed to be kind of like the ending of a tea ceremony for Omotenashi. And if you don't know what that is, look it up. It is a pretty cool homage that Lexus incorporates in a lot of their cars. Sometimes even when you roll up the windows, they slow down at the end. And that's kind of a cool historical detail. It's like a little Easter egg in the cars, which is pretty cool. Otherwise, the door handle on the LC is a floating design. It is up here. And the seat controls are on the seat like every other Lexus and Toyota, where you can kind of just do them from the side. Now, it's interesting on the LC because if you have the seat reclined, like far back, and you go to move the seat back, it won't let it really rub on the back seat. It'll actually kind of adjust it for you, which is interesting. The Jaguar did rub. I noticed even though there isn't a back seat, it did rub on the panels there. So a little bit difference there. Also on the LC, I don't know if you're gonna be able to see it, is there is something for the passenger to look at. And that's this artwork that's right here. So it is kind of backlit. There is a little bit of a Lexus design to it. And I always thought that was pretty cool because as a passenger, you usually don't have a whole lot to look at. It's not that you're gonna sit there and think about the artwork and what it means and stuff, but it is just pleasing to look at. It is, instead of just like a plastic panel, it is something that kind of, you know, is comfortable for your eyes, I would say. Another similarity is the glove box. So not something you're gonna open very often, maybe a couple times a year, but all you do is just press that little button there. It's electronic and it opens up. It's a very calm approach to it, I find. And I think that's pretty cool. So instead of having just a little lever, you just very calmly press that button and it's kind of soothing. I know it's something small, but I'm a nerd for small details. So I do like it. And then we have some vents up here. The Jaguar has the two center vents that can hide and pop back up. The Lexus doesn't have that cool party trick. However, you know, it does have some other nice details in here, like some Alcantara on the top of the gauge cluster there and the LFA-inspired EFT display. So a little bit more modern because of the timing of these two particular vehicles and their design. So the infotainment and the electronics are a little bit more up to date on the LC versus the F-Type. But when it comes to technology, what's up to date today in 5 years from now is gonna be out of date anyway. But things like, you know, transmissions and engines and stuff like that, you know, stays as raw as they are. I did notice the sun visor here is a little bit smaller on the Jag, same with the mirror, but on the LC, it is still pretty tiny too. I can fit my whole face in the vision, which is something where on the Jaguar, it was just my eyes or just my lips. Again, not a big deal. I'm not saying one's better than the other, but just something, just one of the little differences that I noticed. So there you have it, a quick comparison of two cars that at first blush might seem very different, but in fact have a handful of similarities. And in the used car market, you never know, you might be looking at a 2016 Jaguar and perhaps an LC of one of the years, whether it's a 2018, 2021, etc. So if you like this comparison video, let us know in the comments, or if there's any other comparisons that you would like to see us do, let us know in the comments, whether it's, you know, Lexus and Toyota or Lexus and BMW, whatever it is, let us know. And if it's possible, I will try to make it happen. Thanks for watching and I'll talk to you next time.